بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, towards the end of my last provisions for the hereafter class, one of the students asked a question, and that question was related to wives, and if it was specified that they must live with the parents of their husbands. Now, this question wasn't specific to the class alone. This is a question I've been receiving over the years, and perhaps even more now than before. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease matters for the ummah. Ameen. The reality is, my dear brothers and sisters, with regards to the Sharia, then there is no specific instruction regarding this. We find nothing in the Quran, nor do we find any specific narration from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stating that as part of the marriage contract, a female should be in the service of her mother-in-law or father-in-law. Now, don't get me wrong, my dear brothers and sisters. This doesn't mean that one should not be in the service of their father-in-law or mother-in-law, because there's one thing known as the hour of rights. And there's another thing known as the R of responsibility. So I just want to clarify that now, so that nobody takes the wrong message or the wrong understanding from my message thus far. We have the R of rights and we have the R of responsibility. And inshallah, we will discuss this just now. But before that, I just want to highlight a cultural problem that we have in many a marriage, especially marriages between families that have an Indian subcontinent origin, right? We find that a lot of the shackles of norms come into play that negatively affect the marriage, right? I cannot count the number of times females have written in, wives have written in newlyweds regarding how they just got married and the marriage is definitely not that which they were expecting. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying females are angels. I'm not saying that we don't have females who make mistakes and that we don't have wives or sisters or females that are not upon ideals. Don't get me wrong at all, dear listener and dear viewer. But I'm talking about females that do get married hoping to be good to their in-laws, hoping to serve their in-laws. But what happens is they get married into a home where this culture of the wife being a slave over and above being a wife exists. And the reality is, my dear brothers and sisters, we marry wives, we don't marry slaves. Just this past week, I received a message from a sister who said that within the first few months of her marriage, her relationship with her husband became spoiled. Why? Because nothing she did was good enough for her mother-in-law. And when he would come back from work, her mother-in-law would complain, obviously. And as a result, he started disliking his wife. Why? Because obviously, you know, a husband is caught in a catch-22 situation, if we can say that, right? It's a tough situation to be in, because here you have to be dutiful to your mother. And here you have your wife who you keep asking to be dutiful to your mother, or you request to be dutiful to your mother, and she agrees. And then every time you come home, or every so often you come home, your mother complains about your spouse. So this is just a recent situation that came through to me. And when I asked my fellow Muslim sister regarding her behavior in the home and so on and so forth, she clearly said that her day starts from the time she wakes and ends ends in the evening. You know, she's expected to cook, she's expected to wash, she's expected to clean, and plus there's several other people living in the home, so she has to take on the burden of doing that for everyone in the home. And then it's a family that has a lot of guests, so now she's baking for them, and the baking never ends, and so on and so forth. So no doubt this situation is burdensome. This is an abnormal situation. This is burdensome. By no way is the sister saying she doesn't want to bake, nor is she saying that she doesn't want to be of service to you know, the brothers and sisters of her husband. But the situation is that the situation is unbearable, right? It's abnormal. And here we have a situation where the husband is refusing to offer a sensitive ear to his wife, nor even ask his wife, you know, to explain her side of things. Rather, he's listening to one side of events and then allowing this to dissolve the love and happiness that he once felt for his wife, and now this is causing the marriage to become sour. Now, from the objectives of the Sharia, or that which the Sharia strives to protect, is the relationship between husband and wife. The Sharia strives to protect this, right? And Shaytan loves to break this unity. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to keep this union together. Obviously, in a way that the two parties live with one another in obedience. They do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst they are together. So the Sharia strives towards protecting the marriage. And whilst we say that we do not have a specific instruction from the Quran or the Sunnah dictating that a female should live with her in-laws, or dictating that a female should be in the service of her in-laws, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does say, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, that the husbands must be with their wives upon that which is good, which the Sharia praises, and that which constitutes the noble values of our norms. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked for. And when a wife enters a situation where she's being treated like a slave in the home that she is in, then this goes against what the Sharia advises. And in fact, this goes against the noble values of our norms. And it is at this period that a husband should act. A husband should act. In fact, the Maliki scholars, rahmatullahi alayhim, have actually said that in this particular instance, if the wife requests to move into her own home, then she's not sinful for doing so, for putting forward this request. She would not be considered sinful, and in no way can the husband raise the matter of her being sinful with any of the authorities, because it's her right to ask for the situation if the situation is unbearable, especially since the Sharia wants to look after the union of the husband and wife, of this couple that has come together. So the Maliki scholars have said this, rahmatullahi alayhim, and in fact they've actually added that if the husband made a decision here to separate his wife from his parents, then he also would not be considered sinful, inshallah, right? Given the explanation that I've just shared, given what the Sharia tries to protect. So وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to live with our spouses upon that which the Sharia praises, and upon those noble values of our communities. Unfortunately, we have allowed certain ills in terms of the norms that we have come to know to shackle us, right? To burden us, right? To hold us down. When the Sharia came to emancipate us from that which causes retrogression, we know that the Sharia came through لِتَكْثِيرَ الْمَصَالِحِ وَتَقْلِيلَ الْمَفَاسِدِ. The Sharia came about to increase goodness, right? And to increase benefit. And it came to reduce and eradicate harm, right? This is what the Sharia came to do. So the Sharia came to emancipate us. And that's why, even though the Sharia does not put an end to all our norms, the Sharia does put an end to those norms that put us in predicaments, harmful predicaments, those values of certain norms that allow harm to increase rather than a decrease. So understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. I know every husband is also in a predicament. I'm not trying to be or not show sensitivity to the situation of the husband, but what I'm putting forward to my fellow brother is to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to do da'wah to his mother and father, and then if need be, separate his wife from the home, so that at least a relationship can exist between your wife and your mother and your father. The last thing you want is your wife making dua against your parents in her dua, right? Because she's oppressed, right? And my advice also is based on the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded us to assist the oppressed as well as the oppressor, right? Assist the oppressed by helping them out of the situation, and assist the oppressed by doing da'wah to them, by advising them the ills of their ways and inviting them towards changing for the better. And no doubt with our parents, we must do so with wisdom. We must do so in the best of ways. So I pray this particular point is understood. Now I want to move on to what I said earlier pertaining to the R of rights and the R of responsibility. And the reason why I want to highlight this is because because what happens is when one part of the discussion is heard, such as this, then sometimes females take to heart this part of the discussion, certain wives take to heart this part of the discussion, and they understand a different message. It's important we balance out the message, right? As I said earlier, I'm not saying that since the Sharia has not directly commanded us towards being dutiful to our in-laws, that we shouldn't, right? Because as I said, we have the hour of responsibility, right? So sometimes it's our right to do something or not to do something, right? However, even though that may be our rights, right, a lot of the time it's our responsibility to do something or leave something. And that's, and I call this the, you know, R versus R, right? The R of rights versus the R of responsibility. This is what I call this particular discussion. I'll give you an example from the best person to have walked the face of this earth, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When we look at our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we see that he sallallahu alayhi wasallam got married to Khadija radiallahu anha, and they lived together. And Khadija radiallahu anha, obviously, she was well to do. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam worked for her radiallahu anha. And the scholars of history, like Ibn Kathir, mentions in Al-Bidayah wa Nihayah, and Ibn Sa'ad mentions in his Tabaqat, that Khadija radiallahu anha had a child called Hind when they got married. And they go on to mention that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with this child the way a real father would be with a child. In fact, better, because he was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, better than a real father would be with his child. This is how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was with Hind. You know, one may say, well, he didn't have to be with Hind like that. It was his right not to be with Hind like that. That's true. But it was his responsibility to do so, right? That's the other R. And thus he, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, did that. And this is what brought them closer together as husband and wife. And this is what grew the love that they had for one another. And this is the reality of marriage, my dear brothers and sisters. We need to grow the love that we have for each other. You know, a lot of the time people say we've fallen in love. And when people say they've fallen in love, I ask them if they're okay, you know, because whoever, you know, fell and never got hurt, right? You know, when you fall, you get hurt. So who said falling in love was the right thing to do? The Sharia tells us to grow in love with one another. This is what's more sustainable, and this is what is more suitable, and this is what makes marriage last a lifetime. You know, this is what makes a marriage exist in such a way that when one party passes away, the other party sincerely misses them. And the other party sincerely makes dua for them. It's not one of those cases where, oh, well, you know what? Yes, it's sad that they passed away, Allahu musta'an, but perhaps there's khair in this because the situation was unbearable. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect. I'm sure some of you are smiling, but this is a serious situation. This is how some spouses actually describe their situation when their fellow spouse passes away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all and bless our marriages. Ameen. So we grow in love with each other, right? The marriage between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and Khadija radiallahu anha was not upon, you know, a spreadsheet, a bank balance sheet. It was not upon what you and I may call a scorecard, right? Where there's deposits and withdrawals. Where the husband says, well, I've done so much good to you, so now I have the right to not look after your rights or not be responsible for so many other days. And the wife says, well, I've deposited, so I'm in surplus, and now I have the right to do the same as well. Absolutely not. And further proof of this is when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted to assist Abu Talib and reciprocate the good that Abu Talib did to him by looking after him after his grandfather passed away. We see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam taking off Abu Talib, his son Ali radiallahu anhu, and he brings Ali into his home, the home that he made with Khadija radiallahu anha. And we see no way Khadija radiallahu anha complaining. We see no way Khadija radiallahu anha, you know, requiring this long discussion, right? This long discussion about whether it should happen, whether it shouldn't happen, and how is it going to be, and we're not going to have time with each other, and so on and so forth. Perhaps, you know, these sort of discussions that might happen between spouses today. No, she happily accepted Ali coming into the home, and she was like a mother to Ali, right? Even though it was her right not to, but out of responsibility, she was. This is how beautiful marriages operate. So understand this, my dear sisters, as well, that whilst, you know, the scholars say that it's not a right upon you as a wife to, you know, be at the feet of your in-laws, Even though the scholar said it's not a right, however, it's a responsibility. Obviously, upon a normal way, not that which causes harm to the marriage, not that which causes harm to the marriage, but upon a noble way. It shouldn't be that as wives we say, well, we're washing our hands off this because Sheikh so and so said that we do not have to be dutiful to our in-laws. No, the fuqaha and the scholars discuss rights. Right, because that's the books of fiqh, you know, is a code of law. They're discussing rights. They're discussing what we should look at when the marriage is what we should look at the bare minimal level for the marriage to be considered a marriage. Right, to be considered a functional marriage. Right, so they're discussing the minimal. It doesn't mean that they didn't say it's not your right. That they didn't advise that you should, nonetheless, and in fact they have. In fact, they have, and they have cited that it will grow the love for your husband towards you as well. So take into consideration this, my dear brothers and sisters. You know, in summary, our wives are wives, they're not slaves. In summary, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Sharia to emancipate us, right? From the shackles of our norms and that which brings us down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the people of the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the unlettered prophet. Right, that will command them towards several things, and this unlettered prophet will be a means of the shackles of their previous laws, the laws of the Torah, the laws of the Injil being lifted. وَيَضَعُ عَنْهُمْ إِصْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ. Right, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being a means of lifting the difficulties that previous nations had as a result of based on the laws that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to them. Right, so this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as with regards to previous revelations. So what about with regards to norms? Right, norms, man-made norms. Right, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as we say, min babi awla, in the first place, came to lift us out of the difficulties and the chaos and the shackles of the ills of our norms. So brothers and sisters, live for the sake of Allah, speak for the sake of Allah, do for the sake of Allah, leave for the sake of Allah, and always remember to behave in a way that creates benefit, that creates a positive environment, and stay away from those ways that leads towards retrogression, that leads towards harm. Indeed, the Sharia only came to increase good and eradicate harm. I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ask Allah to bless these few words and bless our marriages. And for those who are not married, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless you with worthy marriages soon. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.